Welcome to PBS NewsHour's continued coverage of the coronavirus pandemic. I'm Daniel Bush in New York, joined by Lisa Desjardins at the Capitol in Washington, D.C. Lisa, you are right in the heart of the action. The House just passed the $2 trillion package. Let's walk through for viewers a little bit what was in there. We have a lot of questions as well from our audience. We will get to these questions, what is in the bill, how it impacts individuals, businesses, and so on. But Lisa, what was the mood there today as this historic vote went through? And then let's go through some of the top lines of the bill itself.
I think my heart rate is still coming down, probably the same for many House members. This has been one of the most dramatic series of events in the past week that the U.S. Capitol, I think, has seen in modern time. And that's saying a lot. There's been a lot of drama here that you and I have both covered together, including the impeachment trial just in the last month and a half.
That's right.
You know, the mood, it was tricky because members clearly almost unanimously wanted to pass this bill, which in of itself is rare, but especially when it is, in fact, the largest one-time spending bill in U.S. history. It just speaks to the sense of the crisis and the sense of the need to pass something. With the exception of one member, that is Thomas Massie of Kentucky, he wanted a recorded vote because his point is that this bill is not paid for, that this down the road will add to our already very large national debt, and he thinks members should be on the record voting for it or voting against it. His effort failed, which also was extraordinary. You only need 1/5 of the U.S. House to get a recorded vote, and you only had one member that wanted it. It was only Tom Massie standing at the end, I think, defeating that effort. When you talk about mood, defeating that idea of having a recorded vote, unified the chamber, and at the end, they passed this by a simple voice vote, not the yeses and the noes. Basically, everyone, are you in favor? Yes. There were just a couple of voices saying no. And at the end, the entire chamber was on its feet, clapping, united. And in fact, Dan, the rarest of things, Speaker Pelosi and her Republican counterpart, Leader Kevin McCarthy, had a news conference together about this. So there is a mood. It is somewhat bipartisan, but it's almost past partisanship. It's almost not related to partisanship at all. There is a sense that there is a very serious crisis and that lawmakers may in fact be overdue in acting and that they needed to do it at least today.
That's remarkable, Lisa, in an era of intense partisanship to see both parties come together in that moment, pass this bill. Of course, all Americans have been waiting all week as Congress has been working through these negotiations with the White House as well to see what would come of it. Let's go through some of big picture parts of this bill. We're going to get into the details. I know you've read every page. I have as well. It's a very long piece of legislation. Before we get into more of the weeds and some of our questions coming in are very specific, sort of describe the universe of funding and aid here. It kind of falls into a couple of buckets, right? There's aid for businesses. Right. There's aid for individuals. Give us a broad overview.
Yeah, that's great. And I think we're tag teaming this. So jump in on what I seem to be leaving out, obviously. I think broadly what this bill is trying to do is sort of on the first burner, try to keep businesses open, try and prevent businesses from having to lay people off. So that's sort of one piece. The second piece is then for people who are laid off or who are in economic need. And then there's a third piece that is sort of help, especially for the medical sector, for the health sector, but also for states and other kind of societal institutions that are trying to deal with this. So I guess starting with the first, trying to keep businesses open. Listen, if you are watching this live stream right now and you are a small business, if you have under 500 employees, you need to pay attention to this bill because Congress is basically saying, we will cover your entire payroll and your rent for 2 months. And you will never have to pay for it as long as you use that money for your rent and for your payroll. So whether you're affected by the coronavirus or not, any small business, they are offering you this money up to $10 million each. So it's something to pay attention to. Then if you are a large business, you can get a federally backed loan. And that could also be very large. You will have a low interest rate for that. that will have to be repaid, but there is a lot of grace period about it. But to get that loan, if you're a large business, you have to commit, you have to say you intend to keep 90% of your workforce. So that's a lot of money. And that, in between those two things is almost $1 trillion of this bill. And then actually, Dan, I know you probably, I'm gonna toss it to you for the help for individuals. People are getting checks and also unemployment's going up. So I'm gonna let you explain all that.
So people are gonna start getting checks in the mail. That's right, Lisa, $1,200 per person, $2,400 for a married couple, $500 for additional children. However, there are income caps on that. A single individual, $75,000. We're talking about $150,000 for a married couple or couples filing jointly. So there are some caps on this, but you know, the thinking was, let's try and get money to as many people as needed as possible. We saw just a little bit earlier this week's Treasury Secretary Steve Mnuchin being asked about how fast those checks are going to come to people. He said as soon as possible. It looks like beginning of April. We do have to wait and see. There's a whole process in this legislation for sort of being informed by the IRS. They're supposed to send out a notice 15 days after these disbursements are made, letting you know how much you got. In case you know you still haven't seen that payment in the mail. So for anybody who's watching who is unsure of how it is that they're going to see that check show up, if it's not being automatically electronically deposited in your bank account, which is the first and ideal option from the IRS's point of view, you will get a check in the mail. But you know, just look in your mailbox for anything IRS related, because they will are required to send you information about the payments that you're getting. So that's part of it. You mentioned unemployment. Yeah, go ahead. I was going to mention unemployment benefits. Go ahead.
Yeah. Just to add to what you're saying. So I had some staffers who are very familiar who've been working on this issue that I spoke to yesterday with IRS. They actually estimated maybe 3 to 4 weeks if you have direct deposit to get this money. But the truth is every day they get more information and it changes. But just so people set their expectations, sometime in April seems right, but it may be closer to the middle of April than the beginning, it looks like, for direct deposit.
That's right. Also, a big piece of this is drastically expanding unemployment benefits. We're seeing this now, and we have some graphics that we'll put up in a partnership with PBS NewsHour with USA Facts. And you can see, you know, just in this past week alone, a record-setting number of unemployment claims, over 3 million, shattering all previous records, Lisa. And so this is a moment in time when suddenly there are a lot of Americans out of work. Another graphic we can put up here, you can see one of the hardest hit sectors, of course, that we're seeing a lot in the news is restaurant workers, people who work in the food and beverage industry. Restaurants around the country in many places have closed, right here in New York. You know, restaurants can't serve people inside the establishment. So we see that those workers are 8% of all non-farm, the labor force, non-farm workers in the country out of work. For individuals like that, these are people who need assistance right now, Lisa, and that's what this unemployment is trying to do. Walk us through a little bit, $600 extra and an expansion to 39 weeks. Talk us through some of the details.
Yeah, you got it. It's an additional $600 over the maximum benefit in your state. As many folks do who have experienced this know that each state has a different maximum amount. That might be new information to others who have never been on unemployment. And this bill basically adds $600 to whatever your state already is offering. And it adds another 13 weeks to what your state is offering. That means there's a maximum nationally. The most any state offers right now is 26 weeks of unemployment. So the most you would see anywhere in this country is 39 weeks. But again, the exact amount and the exact time depends on your state. It will be a great deal more. You know, Dan, there was a lot of controversy about this, adding the $600, because for some Americans, that will mean that an unemployment check will be more than their regular payroll check if they've been laid off. Some Republicans had a real problem with that. However, the reason they did that, Dan, is because the state formulas for unemployment are complicated. The states are not able, they told Congress, to just set a limit on 100% of your income for some reason. It seems like it should be easy, but it's apparently very difficult for states to do that. So they added $600. Why? because the average unemployment benefit, or I'm getting super nerdy now, the average unemployment benefit is around $300 right now, and the average weekly pay in America is around $900. They added $600 to try to get to the average weekly salary for people in America, and they just wanted this to get out fast, so that's why they did it that way.
So Lisa, let's look at some of our questions. Yeah. A lot coming in. A lot of people wondering, you know, how to do aspects of this legislation, this new bill that just will become laws when it gets signed by President Trump. How does it affect them specifically? A lot of questions coming in. And let's start with one the topic that we're just talking about, which is unemployment, individuals who are out of work. We have a question from LB who says, will adult individuals who have not been employed for several years be getting a check as well? And that speaks to in the recovery from the Great Recession of 10 years ago, a lot of individuals who have been looking for work and haven't been able to find it, right? Or have been underemployed for months, if not years, in the case of this person here.
Right. And so I think if they mean, will adult individuals who haven't been employed be getting a check, meaning that $1,200 check, the direct payment check? Yes, absolutely.
If they qualify on the income cap.
That's right. The idea. So everyone who gets that, the people getting that check, it's anyone who has basically a tax ID. If you have, mostly that's people who file taxes, but some people need tax IDs for other reasons. So this could be people who are legal permanent residents. This could be people who haven't filed taxes for a couple of years, but have a tax ID and pushed back their taxes. But basically, if you are or have been a tax filer, you will get that check. Now, if you're talking about the unemployment benefits, I don't think that's what they meant. But if you are, you have to have been currently put out of work. Someone who's been out of work for a couple of years, who's already run through the expired amount of time, would likely not qualify for that. It's someone who's been newly or recently unemployed.
And Lisa, you know, just to put a fine point on that too, in this bill, there are a lot of very specific criteria for who is eligible for what, right? Whether you're an individual applying for unemployment insurance, whether you're a small business. So, and this speaks, I think, to some concerns, especially from Republicans, as you mentioned, to make sure that the money would really get to the people who need it most. And so, for example, for unemployment, you do need to, there's a list that you need to check off to show that you were affected by the coronavirus. Mm-hmm. You need to have been diagnosed or experiencing symptoms of COVID-19, which, contributed to you losing your job. Additionally, you had to quit your job because, you couldn't get to your employment. Maybe your job, your workplace is still open, but you can't get there because of a quarantine. So people who are watching this, who are thinking about, how it is to apply for unemployment, make sure that you meet the criteria in order to get this help.
That's exactly right. And I think it's also, businesses have to make very difficult decisions about that too, whether they stay open, whether they close. I had an epic chat with the parents at our daycare about all of this, because our daycare is really struggling to figure out what to do. Remarkably, they're still open, but they're down to very few students per classroom. They're trying to figure out, are they going to close soon? Are they not? As a small business, what do they do? Do they take the money? Do they not? People need to really look at the specifics here. You're right. And I think that brings me, if you don't mind, I'm going to raise a question and toss it to you. From Twitter, we've got a question about small businesses, which is, how do small businesses apply for the loans? My understanding is that could be through almost any bank, and the banks are now working on that specific process. But Dan, this raises the bigger question about the giant small business package in this bill. Talk about what you see in that, and what do you think small businesses need to know about that?
That's such a good question. Thank you for raising that, and to our everyone watching along, you keep sending in your questions. There's a lot of money here for small businesses, but as you said, Lisa, there are a lot of trade-offs and important questions that small business owners have to ask about how it is that they're going to get through this period of time. So as you mentioned at the top of this, up to $10 million through the end of September to cover expenses, to cover costs. If you, however, elect to get that pot of money to stay afloat, essentially, it does lock you out of other funding and assistance in this bill. So you have to decide essentially what is the bottom line? How can I best stay open as a small business and retain my workforce? And when you start looking through how this aid is structured, Congress is really prioritizing keeping people in their jobs, right? You mentioned, you know, for bigger businesses, retaining 90% of your workforce. In order to get a lot of this assistance, small business owners have to keep as many of their employees going as possible and using the money directly to do that. And in fact, the small businesses apply for these loans and don't use them to do some of these things. They have to pay them back. If they do use them to keep their employees in their jobs, to pay their benefits, their healthcare benefits, and so on, they're grants. They don't have to pay them back. But Congress is looking very closely at that. And small businesses, again, just to get to this viewer's question, need to go through a series of steps to show how it is specifically that they were impacted by the coronavirus. So it's not enough for a small business owner, whether you know it's a deli or someone selling clothing or whatever the case may be. You can't just raise your hand and say, "Hey, I want money in this." You need to say,
"You know what?
Show how you were." Your shortage in supplies, your supply chain was affected. You lost receipts, you lost income in this moment, disruption in shipping.
You know what I think though, Dan? I think though, Dan, you know, this has been this is a really good point. This is an open question. I talked to Democrats again yesterday, who have been involved in this small business portion of the bill. And I actually think, and they told me, I don't think there's any coronavirus qualification on this small business, the Paycheck Protection Act part that we're talking about. And I think a lot of people have missed that. And I had to read the bill carefully. And I called and I said, "Hey, they don't have to have a coronavirus effect to get this small business like floating the payroll for 8 weeks portion." And all sides told me, yes, we think that's right. And we did that to try and get this out the door quickly. So people need to, people should understand that we're still understanding this. And the same with the staff who wrote this bill, it all came together so quickly. They're still getting their hands around what it does and doesn't do. But I will say, Dan, I think any small business, even if you're in a place that has not been affected by the coronavirus right now, may be eligible for this money, as long as you have fewer than 500 workers, and as long as you use the money for your payroll and your rent. Now, among the choices that you're talking about, which is exactly right, people have to understand what the money does and doesn't do. It is for basically 8 weeks or 250% of your payroll. So you don't get it all the way through September. You sort of have to pick that 8 week window that you think you are going to need the most. So a place that isn't affected by coronavirus now might not want it now because they might really need it later. And those are the choices that they have to make.
That's a good point, and it is true that we're all going through sort of figuring out exactly what's in here, what's not. The payroll protection, I'm glad you made that clear, the payroll protection is there regardless. Another interesting thing before we get to more questions that jumps out is the prioritizing small businesses in rural areas, in underserved areas, minority and women-owned businesses. That language is not quite in the bill, but that's what they're getting at. And there are a lot of different places here where Congress is trying to push aid to less populated parts of the country where people may have more trouble or more difficulty accessing it.
Yeah, you can feel the effect of sort of the rural members of Congress on this bill.
You definitely can.
And I think among them, one that stood out to me was with the airlines. You know, the airlines are getting, it depends on how you want to cut it. Basically, the passenger airlines get about $25 billion in a grant, maybe another $25 billion in loans. But one of the qualifications on that, and they have a lot of requirements as well. One of them is that they could be required to continue their routes. They can't shutter every route in the country. And there's language in that portion of the bill that is specific, saying airlines have got to consider, and the secretary who oversees all this must consider the needs of rural communities in that, and that they can't just keep the air traffic going between big cities. They need to find a way to help people in rural America get back and forth while we're keeping the airlines afloat. So they definitely have made a big effort there to make sure rural America is not left behind, at least considered in a lot of this.
Yeah, that's such a good point. We have another question. I'll throw this to you, Lisa, from Mara Cox on YouTube, who asks, if you owe money for student loans, we can get into student loans in this bill. Mara asks, if you owe money for student loans and your tax refund goes automatically to that, will this $1,200 do that as well?
You know, I don't think so, but I will ask this question. Mara, that's a very good question. And I have we have something else to say about student loans, but the way this direct payment goes, the recovery refund, they're calling it, they're all about alliteration in this bill. This recovery refund, the $1,200, is technically a tax credit on your taxes next year. Just follow me. This is like congressional logic. It's a tax credit on your taxes next year that is refundable, and you're getting it this year. So in the end, that means it's not going to change your taxes next year. That's just how they're accounting it, because obviously the taxes for last year are already being processed. And it's sort of a mechanism they're using. But because of that, Mara, because it is a refund for next year, I suspect that there'll be something on next year's tax form dealing with this for you guys who use it for student loans. I will check on this, but I do not think this money is on a whole separate stream. And also, at the same time, Dan, you can talk about what's going on with student loans in this bill, because there's some good news for those who have federally backed student loans in this.
Right, and that's the key. Federally backed student loans, suspended payment through September 30th, some relief for a couple of months, no interest during that period, wage garnishment, if that was the case for people who were behind on their loans, that is suspended as well. And lenders are, this is going to be tricky to sort of figure out, but in the legislation, lenders are required to notify borrowers of what is happening. I believe it's within 15 days, Lisa, of when the act passes. So that will be in the next couple of days, as soon as Trump signs it into law. And then you will, if you have a student loan, you will get notification in the mail saying these are the terms. You know, you have a couple of months of respite. And all these other provisions tagged on. And of course, Lisa, this was a big issue, or has been a big issue, in the Democratic presidential primary, right? We've seen a lot of candidates talking about forgiving student loans, of the vast majority of loans. And now all of a sudden, it takes a pandemic, but that is happening in the short term for a couple months.
Yeah, for a couple months, exactly. At one point, Joe Biden was proposing like some larger student loan forgiveness as part of this. You know, and Dan, I got to be honest, I wouldn't be surprised if this comes back again and soon, because right now this is sort of, this is not even a bandaid on the wound. This is basically just trying to like assess the patient, get the patient into the hospital, trying to help America just even keep breathing through this hit of this virus, economic and health. And then once we get past a few weeks and we see where we're at, there very much is expectation here in Congress that there will need to be another bill that is sort of more classic stimulus, meant to encourage the economy, encourage people to buy again, give people more money and stimulate the economy. And I would be shocked if there is not some discussion, certainly from the Democrat side, of trying to forgive student loans as part of that.
Yeah, I think we're going to see that as well. And you raised such a good point before we get to another question, which is that so much of this is really just about stopping the pain for the next couple of months, right? Trying to keep the economy from really nosediving, you know, through essentially the end of the summer, through the end of September, the end of the fiscal year. And again, as you said, after that point, Congress is going to have to, before that even, revisit this and say, what can we do next? But in the meantime, if you do have student loans, you have, you know, a couple of months of respite there. Let's go back to more of our questions. We have a question from Wayne on Facebook. Lisa, Wayne says, I am a disabled vet. My wife and I filed taxes in 2018. Is that what they are basing the distribution amount on? So when you're looking to see if you qualify based on these income caps, are we talking 2018, 2019?
Right. They're basing it on your status in 2019. The only reason, I mean, technically, it ultimately will be based on your status this year. But when they first cut this money, when they first send it out, it's going to be based on your most recent tax year, which is of 2019, if you filed already. You're right, it could be 2018 if you haven't filed yet.
If you haven't filed,
it's whatever your most current tax status is with the IRS. And that the main thing that would affect Wayne, you probably picked up on this, is if you were married or not, or if you were a head of household. So if you're single, if you were single then and you're married now, it would sort of change how you would get the money. And if you, or if you're single with a child, called head of household, that could affect things. I posed this exact question to the staffers helping write the bill and who knew about this bill yesterday, and said, well, what if your status changes, you know, by next year? And they said, we anticipate that there will be something in next year's tax code and next year's tax forms that will deal with that. And I don't know which way it will go. If you end up losing money, maybe they forgive it. Maybe they just give people sort of the benefit of whichever is the most beneficial status to you, you get. I don't know. But for now, it is your most recent tax year status.
That's right. Let's go to another question. I think this is one that a lot of people are wondering. So I'm glad that Victoria brought it up. This is Victoria J. Coe on Twitter said, how would the bill benefit freelance contract workers? So someone who is not working for a company, is sort of is on their own, is working as a freelancer, is a contractor for someone. How would that work?
I'm going to push that back to you because Dan, as a journalist who's married to a journalist, I know this is something that you understand, the freelance and contract world. So I'll let you answer
this.
That's
right. There is a lot of language for people who are self-employed, for people who are sole proprietors. You qualify for these a range of benefits, particularly as a business person who is self-employed and is essentially running a shop. So yes, the short answer is you are not left out of this legislation. Again, there is a criteria process in some cases for how it is that you qualify, for you need to show a good faith effort. That's some of the language in the bill for how it is that you're going to use the money to pay your business costs if your costs have gone down and so on. But sole proprietors, contractors, they are there too. And they're all over this bill. So Congress was really looking, I think, at what the workforce looks like in the 21st century, Lisa, and saying, you know, there is an increase in people who fall into that category, and they made sure that they weren't that they didn't slip through the cracks here.
And so people know this is one of the expansions, just to add, because you got that exactly right, that specifically on unemployment benefits, this is a category that many freelancer contract workers have had a lot of trouble qualifying for. In fact, for freelancers, sometimes it's almost impossible to get unemployment benefits. They have made it easier, they say in this bill, for you to get unemployment benefits. But I think the states have to work out exactly how that qualification criteria works. But also, really notably, the Small Business, that Paycheck Protection Act, the money that would pay for 2 months of payroll, 8 weeks of payroll, that specifically says it can go to contractors. And I believe it is also meant, as you're saying, for freelancers who kind of are self-employed. There's also a specific provision for contractors who work for airlines that can get, or that have, that are airline contractors. There's like $3 billion, I think, in loans for them. So that's a very specific, I don't know if that happens to be you, Victoria, but there's a lot in here for freelance and contract workers. This is something I think Democrats in particular brought to the table, but that Republicans were very open to and agreed with.
So we have more questions coming in. Before we get to the next one from one of our viewers, Lisa, let's talk a little bit about, we've talked a lot about the economic impacts. Let's talk a little bit about the measures to help mitigate the health, public health issues, you know, in this raised by this pandemic. You know, tests are rising, over 1,000 deaths. Yesterday, we passed the 1,000 death mark in the United States. We're hearing reports, including that we've reported on the NewsHour, of hospitals overrun with patients showing symptoms, hospitals lacking the basic protective medical equipment that they need, masks, ventilators for patients, and so on. Let's talk a little bit about what is in this bill to tackle both protecting healthcare workers and then also just sort of planning around how to deal with pandemics in general. What stands out to you on the healthcare side?
There's a lot. And to be honest, I'm still getting my hands around that portion today. But there's something like, there's sort of two big tranches of money. One is direct for medical and hospital and health needs. The other is for states. And there's a lot of thinking that a lot of the state money will go to public health needs. That could be standing up hospitals, as I know Governor Cuomo's doing in your state of New York. It could be preparedness, masks, say in more rural states like South Dakota. But it's whatever the state needs. And it's the thinking is that will also be public health money for the health sector. And those two pots of money together are almost $300 billion. I have a lot of questions about that, how the hospital money works myself in this bill. But I'm going to hand it back to you because I wonder, because I want to hear what you saw in the bill on those two fronts.
Sure. So, I mean, you know, one very, very basic, and I think that the aid to states is so critical, $150 billion overall in the bill, which will, you know, theoretically give states and localities a lot of control over how it is that, that they deal with this public health emergency. One very basic thing I think viewers should know is that this bill does cover the costs of testing, and that's very, very important. If testing is not covered in your existing health insurance plan, your provider is required to administer it, and they get paid back. So this bill is trying to take that cost off the table, which we've seen in reporting around the country is an issue for some folks who don't have access to healthcare or who struggle to deal with healthcare costs and have questioned whether or not they can even afford to go get tested. Now, whether or not there are enough tests, of course, is another issue, Lisa, right? Because we're seeing a lot of places, we don't have enough testing here in New York. The numbers have been going up because there wasn't a lot of testing until just a week and a half ago. But in the cases where people can get tested, this law does have, or bill does have, a provision to cover that cost.
I mean, I spoke to a member of Congress who was in contact with another member of Congress, Senator Rand Paul, who has been diagnosed as positive with the test. And the second member of Congress said they're not getting a test because there weren't enough tests and they didn't have symptoms, you know, so they said they were advised not to get the test. And that's wild, but it's true. And same Seth Moulton, another congressperson, has complained he would like to be tested. He has symptoms. He's isolating at home. But he was told, don't come in unless you are so sick that you need emergency care. Don't come in for a test. We don't have the test. And it's a very wild and frustrating, hard to fathom situation for our health sector. Let me ask you another question. There's some great questions in here. Denise Flygirl, excellent handle on YouTube. Nicely done. She's asking, are corporations receiving money obligated to not lay off employees? Can they buy back stocks? Can they give dividends? Can they give CEO bonuses? Dan, take us through. This was such a huge part of negotiations, especially over the weekend. This is why the bill stopped for a few days. How did this end up? What limits are there on the corporations that get loans and help from the government here?
Such a good question. As you said, this was the sticking point for days between Democrats and Republicans and the White House. The short answer is, there is a good amount of oversight and restrictions here. No to dividends, no to stock buybacks. You, Lisa, laid out very nicely the pay caps in a piece online. If you go to the NewsHour website, that gives us a breakdown of the bill. If you are a high-earning, senior-level, essentially, official member of a large corporation and you earn more than $3 million, or you earned more than $3 million in calendar year 2019, you can make in this year that same amount plus half of anything that you earn above that. So this was a sort of range of restrictions that Democrats really, really wanted, that they pushed for, and interestingly saw President Trump, a Republican who in a lot of other areas of the economy has pushed for deregulations, restrictions, who pushed for lowering the corporate income, the corporate tax level in the big tax bill that they passed a couple of years ago. Here, he said, actually, I don't want stock buybacks. It took him a couple of days to get there, but the president did eventually take that position. And I think, Lisa, that helped sort of change the tenor of the negotiations to a certain extent, right? When the president came out and said, you know, I understand that we don't want money that the federal government, that the taxpayers are giving to these big corporations to simply be used to enrich their shareholders. We want to make sure that this money goes towards retaining workers.
You know, I think my sense, you know, following being up here for those negotiations, which is to say way, way outside of the room, but talking to staffers who were in there, talking to senators as they came and went, is that the stock buybacks wasn't as hard of a problem. It's interesting to me that really quickly Republicans, as this was coming together, wanted some limits on the corporations. I think they had kind of the stain of TARP on them still, which was very unpopular for many Republicans back from the 2008 Great Recession. But I don't know, Dan, what the exact toughest parts of that were. I know it was tough. I wouldn't be surprised if it was CEO pay and sort of the requirements for how many workers they have to keep on payroll for how long. There was a feeling from Republicans that it was there were too many requirements. But I think the stock buybacks and the generally limiting executive pay was mostly agreed to. I think it was working out how far it went might have been. And that was tough. That was very tough.
Yeah. And also, of course, not just the stain of TARP or sort of lingering controversy around that, but also just the recent tax overhaul that I mentioned, Republicans or Democrats, I should say, were arguing that, you know, if you lower corporate tax rates, companies are not going to invest in the economy. They're going to invest or you know, pay back, reward their shareholders, and so on. And I think that Republicans were sensitive to that as well. We have time for just one or two more questions. So as they come in and we're compiling our last question to Lisa, a question from me to you. Now that this bill has passed in the House, we're of course waiting for the president for it to get to his desk and for him to sign into law. What is the next week and 2 weeks and 3 weeks going to look like in Congress in terms of how they're going to tackle this issue? Are they going to immediately start working on something else? Are they going to try and do non-coronavirus related things? We're getting a lot of interest from people saying, you know, does our government continue like normal? So my question to you, you're there right now. Are we in a longer term holding pattern of weeks and months, or now that this piece is done, are we going to move on to a certain extent and tackle other issues?
We are very far from normal times. And each day, I think we get farther from normal times. The truth is that I'm not sure when Congress will be back. The Senate has adjourned until April 20th with the provision that they will come back in need if there is an emergency reason for them to come back. The House technically has left and they will come back for what's called a pro forma session Tuesday. But, you know, that could just be as few as one or two members. And we see that all the time. That's kind of just a holding place for the House. That will mean that staff has to return here, the staff that keeps the House operating, a minimal amount of staff probably. But all of this is to say is that I think Congress has concluded its business, including committee hearings, all of the public business that it's doing, anything that you would see or that you and I would be able to attend or cover is concluded and it's completely frozen for we don't know how long. Now, staff will continue to work behind the scenes. I understand that some staff in some committees are trying to figure out ways to continue their business while everyone is either virtually or literally isolated from each other. They're trying to figure out new paradigms for conducting business that way. Some reports will continue, some of that kind of thing. But as for actually passing laws, we don't expect to see any of that outside of something that could be having to deal with the coronavirus. You know, it's interesting, Dan, part of this too, one question is in this bill, one of the oversight mechanisms for the money for corporations is an inspector general. It's got a great name. It's like inspector general for the pandemic. It's like pandemic inspector general. It's got this like wild name. And that person is to be nominated by the president but needs to be approved by the Senate. So there's a lot of questions about that. You know, Chuck Schumer said that can't happen at least until April when they come back. Do they find a different way to do that? You know, there are many people in Congress advocating for remote voting here. The leaders of each body Mitch McConnell and Nancy Pelosi have been resistant. Mitch McConnell gave me a flat no when I asked him about this. But I think the pressure is mounting, especially now because so many of their own members have been affected directly. It's changed the voting calculus. In fact, Republicans almost lost a majority in the Senate over the weekend because they had so many members quarantining. They just a one vote majority. So this is to say, who knows? Right now, things are not normal. For the moment, Congress is not conducting public business. They are trying to figure out how to do that, but we don't know if they will and when they will. So, I want to take a question from Marsha that I get a lot, too. Marsha on Facebook's asking quickly, is supplemental security income for those recipients, is that covered in the stimulus package? A lot of folks know this is a portion of Social Security that especially affects some folks who are disabled or blind. It's a few populations that are affected by that specific income. And there's a lot of questions. Marsha, I can tell you that I have been told that that group will get these recovery relief checks, the $1,200 per person, even if you don't file taxes, because you, as a recipient of that benefit already, of SSI, you have a tax ID, I'm told, and that because of that, you will be included. And you are they want this population basically to be as broad as possible. And it's not everyone who owes taxes or filed taxes next year, but they want to include as many Americans as they can. And this population, I'm told, is included. You will get the $1,200 check. And if you happen to have a small business, which I guess I don't know if you'd be on SSI if you did, or if you know people who in your community have small businesses, this will help them too. But certainly you will get people on Social Security in any form should be getting the $1,200.
Such an important question. Thank you so much, Marsha. And thank you so much, Lisa. Pleasure to talk to you. Breaking it down from Capitol Hill, where the House just passed this massive, biggest one-time spending plan in U.S. history. We'll see how it all plays out. As you said, we won't be going back to normal anytime soon. So much in this story. Lisa, thank you so much. I'm Daniel Bush, and thank you.